Good morning and welcome to AMSA's webinar titled Connecting Languages and Cultures Through Interpretation. My name is Sabrina Ziegler and I am AMSA Settlement Coordinator and I will be guiding us through today's webinar. I would like to thank Immigration, Refugees and Citizenship Canada, IRCC, for funding today's event. So before we begin with the webinar, I would like to go through a few housekeeping points. On the right-hand side of the GoToWebinar platform, you will find a control panel that can be expanded and collapsed by clicking on the little orange arrow that can be found on the right. It is possible to expand that or to minimize it depending on your preference. In the audio tab, you will have two options to listen to today's audio. Either through your mic and speakers, as most of you are doing currently, or through your telephone. By clicking on the telephone function in that control panel, it will reveal a Canadian 647 number to call and an access code and a PIN number for you that you would need to enter. Please note that long distance charges may apply if you connect to the audio depending on your telephone plan. We will be having a question and answer period at the end of the webinar, and please submit your questions at any time during the webinar using the question box or email your questions to events@amsa.org. For any technical difficulties that you may experience during today's webinar, please contact my colleague Lucy Buchanan Parker at projects@amsa.org, or you can give her a call at 604-718-2784, and Lucy will be more than happy to assist you if there's any need. Just as a reminder, today's webinar is being recorded and we will be posting the recording to the AMSA website along with any other resources that are going to be discussed or provided during this webinar. In addition, AMSA is also creating a quick links resource page that's going to be on our website that will be dedicated to this subject. We will be sending out a notification once both of these resources are online using SetNet. And so if you do not receive the weekly updates from SetNet, you can go to our website and sign up, and it's free and open to anyone. So the AMSA team will be live tweeting today's event. Join in the conversation, connect with other webinar participants online, and submit your questions using the hashtag AMSAEvents. And AMSA's Twitter handle is @AMSABC. Are you watching this webinar in a group? We'd love to know, so tweet us or email us the photo of you in your group watching the event today. So today we will be hearing from six different speakers, so we have a jam-packed agenda for today's webinar. And these presenters will be sharing their insights and knowledge on working with interpreters in various different settings. So we will be starting off the webinar today with our first speaker, who's going to be Michael Rodano from STIBC, and I'll be introducing him very shortly. And he's going to be talking about the overview of interpreting. Following his presentation, we will hear from Yolanda Salazar-Hoburo from the Vancouver School of Interpreting and Translation on the ethics of interpreting. As well, Mariana Martinez-Vieira, who works for VAS, will be providing us with some practical insights into working with interpreters in a trauma therapy setting. Following these three speakers, we will be looking more into how we can effectively work with interpreters, and we will be hearing a presentation by Young Jo, who is a certified medical interpreter. And we will also be hearing from Annette Floyd, who works for Bridge Clinic. Annette will be sharing with us some practical examples of working with interpreters. And then I would like to welcome Yolanda back as one of our speakers. And she will be sharing some insights into the logistics and culture of interpreting and working with an interpreter. Following Yolanda's presentation, Annette will briefly join us again to share a few practical issues when working with clients from various diverse cultures and using interpreters. Our final presenter will be Brian Corey, who is a registered ASL interpreter, and he will be presenting on working effectively with a sign language interpreter. So we will have a jam-packed agenda for today, as you can see, so we will be getting started right now. So I would like to introduce our first speaker of the day, who is Michael Rodano. He is the Executive Director of the Society of Translators and Interpreters of British Columbia, STIBC, which is an organization that is based in BC, in Vancouver, BC. Michael has over 25 years of international experience in engineering, project marketing and sales, business development, business management, IT management, and consulting, and both for the for-profit and non-for-profit sectors. His passion is to lead, motivate, and support board of directors and staff in achieving challenging strategic goals. Most recently, Michael was on the board of the BC chapter of the Canadian Association, Society of Association Executives, and he has a degree in business from Simon Fraser University and is a certified association executive. Michael, thank you so much for presenting and sharing the first portion of today's webinar.
Thank you, Sabrina.
So if you would like to start off by introducing your topic.
Yes. So what I will do is give everybody an overview of what interpreting is about and what role our society plays in this area in British Columbia. So next slide, please. So in everyday parlance, a lot of people don't know the difference between translation and interpreting. So day to day, most people interchange the terms. But the reality is translation are things that are done in written form, and interpreting is when we facilitate communication orally from one language to another, especially amongst speakers who do not speak the same language, of course. And there are many historical background we can go over in terms of what translation and interpreting is about. But let's just say that without interpreting, history would not have evolved the way it has today. So we're quite thankful for that. Next slide, please. So in terms of careers that an interpreter can have, in your day-to-day lives, you may not encounter interpreters. And this is just to give you an idea as to where interpreters work. So they can work in-house for large corporations that deal with that do business globally. You can also have independent interpreters that the public can hire to go with them for different purposes, like going to ICBC, for example, for driver license test. And also business clients can choose to hire interpreters directly. You have interpreters that work in court, you have interpreters that work in conferences, in medical setting, in the community, especially in settlement services organization. Also, you have interpreters that work for consulates or embassies. And last but not least, you have interpreters that work in media. As an example, some of our members work for CBC. Next slide, please. So what we're seeing globally is the recognition that interpreting is not just something that that people that just speak two languages do. It is indeed a profession, and it is being recognized more and more so as time goes by. There are international standards being written or have been written to professionalize interpreting. The key things to remember is that an interpreter has to follow a certain code of ethics. They have to be accurate, they have to maintain confidentiality, so when you employ an interpreter, they can't share your information with others. They cannot take sides in interpreting, they have to be impartial, they have to respect the people they're working with, and they have to know what their role is. So as an interpreter, they shouldn't be giving advice and things of the sort. As the society that represents interpreters in BC, we hold our members accountable for their behavior, and they have to behave as true professionals. And last but not least, things change, so professional interpreters have to continue to make sure that their skills are up to date continually. Next slide, please. So what exactly do interpreters do and how they do it? So there are different modes of interpreting. There's simultaneous interpreting, whereby the interpreter interprets as the speaker is speaking. So it's simultaneous. You will see these people in conferences and other settings. The other mode of interpreting is consecutive interpreting, whereby a speaker will say one or more sentences, and then the interpreter will interpret. In court, there's a lot of whispered interpretation, whereby the interpreter will quietly whisper what is being said to the plaintiff or complainant. And last but not least, there's a mode of interpreting called side translation, whereby a document in one language is interpreted in a different language. And one thing to keep in mind is the fact that somebody has all of these skills does not necessarily make that person an interpreter that can be efficient and effective in every setting. So in addition to these skills, interpreters have to learn about the context in which they are going to be interpreting and the subject matter. So I'll talk about those in a little bit in the next slide. So as an example, a conference interpreter, they will typically be in a setting, they may be in a booth at a huge conference, and they not only have to do the interpreting, they almost have to act as actors or actresses, whereby they have to try to maintain the tone, the excitement, or whatever mood the original speaker is in, to try to convey not just the words, but the emotions around that. And of course, conference interpreters, typically, they don't go on for too long, or else they can go totally crazy. So they typically take turns of 20 to 30 minutes each, and they work for different settings, mostly at conferences. Next slide, please. And then you have court interpreters. So court interpreters have to not only be able to do side translation, whispered interpreting, and consecutive interpreting, they have to have very good knowledge of all the legal terminology, how the Canadian legal system works, what the court procedures are. And so in addition to base interpreting skills, they have to know about Canadian law quite a bit and how to behave in court. Next slide, please. And then you do have medical interpreting, and that's a subject that will be spoken about quite a bit more later on. So as with court interpreters, the medical interpreters have to have knowledge of the Canadian health system, what the procedures are in a medical setting. They have to be sensitive to cultural differences. And also, in a medical setting, there may be very difficult situations, health issues, and mental health issues. So they have to maintain their composure throughout all of this. And I know that some medical interpreters have to themselves receive counseling just to make sure they're not unduly influenced by what goes on during their day-to-day work. Next slide, please. Last but not least is community interpreting. So a community interpreter will be one that you will see in settlement services areas, police forces, educational settings, and they have to be very culturally aware and act as an ambassador, if you want, of different cultures while maintaining the ethical standards by which they have to live. And that's the tricky part, but that's the job. Next slide, please. So whenever you use an interpreter, you want to make sure that they will abide by the code of ethics that I mentioned earlier. And as such, we do recommend that those who use interpreters always use interpreters who are true professionals. And hence, it is a good idea to ask an interpreter, if he or she does belong to a society that holds them accountable, and to show you their membership card. With that, I thank you very much for giving us a chance to tell you about our society and what the role of interpreters are in British Columbia. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Michael, and thank you so much for sharing the information, providing us with the context for today's webinar. So I'd like to introduce our next speaker, who is Yolanda Salazar-Hoboro, and she will be coming in multiple times throughout today's webinar. Yolanda is the head of the school for the Vancouver School of Interpreting and Translation. She is a graduate of San Jose State University in Romance Languages, Vancouver Community College in Court Interpreting, and has studied 2 years law at UBC. Yolanda has 34 years experience working as an interpreter and translator and as well as teacher in both Canada and the United States. Yolanda is a U.S. federally certified court interpreter and certified in Canada by CTTIC as a court interpreter, certified conference interpreter, certified translator, and she's also a certified interpreter for the Canadian Immigration and Refugee Board, IRB. Yolanda's career spans many areas, always maintaining a balance between training future interpreters and working as an interpreter herself. Prior to becoming the founding head of the school of the Vancouver School of Interpreting and Translation, she was a senior instructor and curriculum developer of the interpreting program at Vancouver Community College. Yolanda is a member of the following professional organizations for interpreters and translators: the American Translation Association, National Association of Judicial Interpreters and Translators, Association of Translators and Interpreters Alberta, as well as the Society of Translators and Interpreters of BC, STIBC. And I'd like to welcome Yolanda to talk about the ethics of interpreting.
Thank you, Sabrina. It is a pleasure to be here with you today, sharing some of what I know about interpreting and ethics. But I think that before we start talking about ethics, I'd like to give you a very brief description of what goes on through an interpreter's head while the interpretation is going on. Next slide, please. So the interpreter has to listen and to understand the message in the source language. So you need a very good knowledge of the language, very good comprehension, not only of the language, but of the different accents that people speak in. We have to remember the entire message, analyze the contents, and reformulate the message in the target language. We cannot just translate the words. We have to get the message and basically dress it up in the proper language so we can vocalize it and give it to the person who doesn't understand the other person's language. So now that you know how the brain works, let's go on with the ethics. So the interpreter's code of ethics, please. Thank you. We're going to start with accuracy, because accuracy, even though it's a skill, it's something that we have to do. It is one of the key points of our code of ethics. And we have to, in order to be accurate, we have to have good memory. For consecutive interpreting, we have to rely mostly on our memory in order to convey the message from one party to the other. In simultaneous interpreting, we don't have to work so much on the memory because we are so busy working with three different skills. We have to listen to the message and understand it, as I said. We have to formulate it and say it while we are listening to the next message. So anytime that an interpreter is working in a conference, they're listening to the original message, listening to their own performance to make sure that no errors creep in, and also giving the message in the target language. So accuracy is a very important component of our code of ethics. Next comes confidentiality. Confidentiality takes many forms because confidentiality involves also the privileged communication between a lawyer and his client, and it also includes the privacy of the client or the patient. Confidentiality means that we keep your secrets are our secrets. We cannot divulge anything that we hear at a meeting. Next. Impartiality or neutrality is another important part of our code of ethics. It means that we have We have no interest in the outcome of the interpreting session. We are there as a neutral party, as a bridge between the people who are actually communicating among themselves. We are just conveying the message from one language to the other, back and forth, not changing it, not adding, not subtracting anything to it. All we do is just convey the message and make sure that the two parties are understanding each other. Next. Now, the limitations of competence is very similar to what Michael said about maintaining boundaries. That means that we know that our job is that of an interpreter, a language bridge between people, and nothing else. We are not advisors, we are not consultants, and we are not members of the bar, we are not members of the medical profession, so we cannot give any advice on any matter that the person may ask outside or inside the setting or the session. And next. Now, the personal limitations is also known as impediments to compliance, and it also includes maintaining your professional standing, making sure that you are that you're competent, that you stay up to date with all the areas of practice, and that you are advancing in your profession. As far as the limitations are concerned, these are the limitations that will make it difficult for us to do our job. It could be limitations because of knowledge, we haven't had enough training. It could be a limitation because of my beliefs, because of my values, because of my traditions and culture. One example that is a very, I like to use it because it's very graphic, is the an interpreter who has very high religious values, who does not believe in abortion, would be a very poor interpreter to have at a clinic where somebody is going to be counseled as to how the abortion process is going to be taking place. So there are times when the interpreter really does not accept certain jobs because they would conflict with their own personal values. And that is a very important thing to keep in mind, because it's always good to ask the interpreter, when you hire them, what the session is going to be like, what kind of topics are going to be discussed, and whether the interpreter is going to be comfortable with that. Now, coming back to confidentiality, which is the main topic of the ethics that we were going to discuss, we can go to the next slide now. Confidentiality and privacy are the core of the ethical principles that we have. Confidentiality has to do with the message. What is it that we hear during the session that makes it a very private thing between the two participants? And the privacy has to do with the physical and emotional comfort of the person that you're interpreting for. Confidentiality means that when we go into a session, we hear everything, we leave the session basically, because everything that you say in the session gets repeated. The session with an interpreter takes twice as long as a session without an interpreter. And the reason why is because the message has to be translated in its entirety, so the message goes out twice. And the answer comes out twice as well, because it has to be translated in its entirety. And at sessions with a professional interpreter, sometimes they might take longer because we do not summarize, but on the other hand, they sometimes take a lot less time because we know what we're doing. And confidentiality, I was asked, when does confidentiality start? Does it start at the beginning of the session? No, it doesn't start at the beginning of the session. It starts way before the session begins. It starts when the interpreter knows the client's name. When the interpreter gets called for an assignment and the details of the assignment are given to the interpreter, that information is already confidential. You may not divulge that information. But on the other hand, confidentiality is something that people have to believe that the interpreter has, because without the interpreter, communication between the parties would not be possible, and there has to be a trust. And in order to be effective in the communication. There has to be a mutual trust between the interpreter and the person that they're interpreting for, and between the professional and the interpreter. And I'm going to digress a little bit here, because I'll tell you a very short story of what happened to me one time. When I went to a lawyer's office and I met the person that I was going to be interpreter for, and he, using very rude language, told me that he didn't want to have an interpreter because interpreters were horrible. And the lawyer basically said, well, if you don't have an interpreter, then I won't be able to interview you because I work with an interpreter. So there was a compromise, and I did the session, and after the session, the man said goodbye and left very abruptly. There was a second session was scheduled for a month later. And a month later, I came back to the session, and I got the warmest greeting that you can imagine. How are you today? It's a pleasure to see you. You're the best interpreter that I've ever had. And I was curious, so I said, why do you think I'm the best interpreter? And the answer was, because nobody asked me what happened on the session that I had last month. And so in the town that I was lived before, whenever I went to talk to my doctor, whenever I went to talk to a lawyer, everybody asked me about it. Everybody knew what was going on, because the interpreters were the gossip queens of town. So that is just one example of confidentiality, how important it is in an interpreting session and for the person who is being interpreted. In order to gain the trust from the non-speaker person, I call them NESs for non-English speakers. Next, please. Then we have to introduce ourselves to the person properly. At the beginning of the session, we should have a couple of minutes to talk to the person that we're going to be interpreting for. And the reason why is because we want to make sure that we speak the same language, that we know what country they come from, so that we can adapt to the varieties of language that may be involved, and also to explain our role, to tell them what an interpreter does. An interpreter is here to make sure that you and your doctor and you or your lawyer can communicate, so that you can ask all the questions that you have, and you can ask your questions, and you can explain things to each other. And I am just there to make sure that you understand each other. I will be your voice in English, and I will be the voice of the professional in your language. And the best way that we can do it is by showing it during the time that we're working, by interpreting clearly, by not asking any personal questions, and by basically staying out of the session. We are not participants in the session. We are merely the language bridge or the language connector, nothing else. After the session is over, the interpreter goes its own way, not revealing to anyone or any type of information whatsoever regarding the parties, any details of the session, or anything that you might have seen or felt about the session. Now, when I say that to seen or felt, it is impossible to go to an interpreting session where there may be emotional aspects or there may be some difficult situation that is not going to somehow affect you. But if you know what your role is from the very beginning, if you know that you are supposed to be just the interpreter, just the conduit, then you can keep those feelings and those thoughts at bay while you're interpreting, and then you can keep them at bay forever. And there are times, and I will explain that later when you need to talk to somebody about that. How are we doing for time?
So thank you so much, Yolanda, for sharing your presentation. I would just like to slowly move us on and welcome Mariana. Thank you so much for sharing so many practical examples and the story you shared about confidentiality. I think that's really valuable and gives us insight of just how the role of an interpreter can be viewed from within the community. So I'd like to just briefly introduce our next speaker, Mariana Martinez Vieira, who is a graduate of the University of Buenos Aires, Argentina, and UBC Counseling Psychology Master's Program. She has 25 years of experience working with survivors of political violence and torture both in Canada and Latin America. When Mariana moved to Vancouver 13 years ago, she joined the Vancouver Association for Survivors of Torture, VAST. Mariana sees her work as a trauma counselor as a way to raise her voice against torture, resist social injustice, and fight for clients' human rights as well as psychosocial well-being. For the last 13 years at VAST, Mariana has seen clients both individually and in groups, and was VAST's group therapy program coordinator, clinical supervisor, and more recently has moved to the role of provincial refugee mental health coordinator. I'd like to welcome Mariana, who's going to share with us some practical examples briefly about the ethics of interpreting within a counseling session.
Hi everyone, and I will take the briefly to heart. So today I'm bringing the perspective of us therapists working with interpreters, providing individual and group counseling to refugees. And mind you, I'm saying working with interpreters, I'm not saying using interpreters. That's where we see the work at VAST, collaboration. So I would like to point out what is different about the conversations that we have in therapy compared to those that we have in other settings, right? And yes, our first slide is there. So in therapy, in trauma therapy, we talk about facts, yes, but most importantly, we talk about clients' experience with facts. And we focus on inner experience. So there are so many languages involved in therapy, and it's definitely a body-oriented conversation because we are doing trauma therapy, and trauma and the body are intrinsically connected. So the language of the body is key. And this is one of the first remarks that I want to make, reminders to interpreters working with us. So, for example, an interpreter can expect us, the therapists, make comments, make statements about what we observe, not only about the content, the story of what client says, rather about what we observe in the client's body. And we call these statements contact statements. There are many of them in sessions. Things like, you took a big breath there, or your body collapses as you talk about your brother, and your eyes gaze far away. So it's so important that interpreters interpret those contact statements as such, not as questions, not attaching meaning, basically interpreting and fundamentally interpreting the statement, the observation that the therapist has made. Not skip them, not taking those contact statements as a random comment, not at all. We need them. These statements are core to the therapeutic process. So that's why I wanted to start by this. Why are they core to the therapeutic process? Because they are meant to help the client direct her attention inside. And that's the inner experience that we focus on in therapy. So, next slide. So, recommendations, suggestions to interpreters from us, the therapist. Self-awareness and body attunement. Key elements of your ongoing training, ongoing exploration. Your comfort, discomfort, the interpreter's comfort, discomfort with feelings, certain identities, difficult experiences, the limitations and values that the interpreter has, as Yolanda was putting it, will come through. And having that awareness of those values, beliefs, and the expression in our bodies are key. So, next slide. How to guide that ongoing journey of self-exploration, self-awareness for interpreters. Some guiding questions that I brought here today on behalf of the VAST team. As an interpreter, are you aware of your blind spots, your assumptions, preconceived beliefs? Are there certain experiences you are particularly challenged with? Certain type of groups, people you're not at home with? Emotions, feelings that you struggle with. Which are the hard ones for you, the super inconvenient ones? Know that. Keep them in mind. The next one. So to add to that reflection activity, that ongoing journey, there's also this other piece. Developing the interpreter's, own body attunement. So what happens inside when you witness sadness, anger, or when you experience it yourself as you're listening to a story? Mind you, these are trauma sessions, trauma counseling sessions. How do you know that you're getting impatient, what are you noticing about it? Or your tone, or the pace of your speech, the eye contact that you make or that you don't make. What is it like to watch someone cry or someone get quote-unquote aggressive or angry? What happens? What is your reaction? Do you move back? Do you move forward? Do you enter a fight or a flight mode to speak in trauma and counseling language? So once I've developed that awareness as an interpreter, the other piece, what could be ways, tools that could help me stay grounded and present in those moments? And these are definitely things that we can talk to interpreters about before and after session, to be building resources for interpreters to get through those moments themselves so that they can help clients get through their own states and reactions. Next one, please. So honoring the therapeutic space entails that self-awareness and that body attunement. Those are some of the biggest skills that interpreters can have to help us therapists honor, create the therapeutic space and honor it. Another big piece, and Michael has already, and Yolanda as well, have already brought this up, the advice-giving piece and the resisting the temptation to give advice. That's how I title it. Because it's going to happen. Because we see it in therapeutic sessions all the time. Interpreters feel an impulse to give the client that support, that encouragement, that tip that they deem necessary at that given point. Because it's hard to sit with difficult emotions and feelings. So we therapists working in this alliance with interpreters and clients, ask interpreters to hold on, to trust that the therapy is not giving the advice for a reason. This therapist is trying to support the client to contact her own experience, to access his or her inner resources, and to ask for help if she deems it necessary. So refrain from giving advice, team up with the therapist. In other words, trust the process. The client will then find the guidance within or ask for it. Right? But of course, again, we go back to the body attunement. That's key. And reaching out to those resources that I as an interpreter have to stay calm, stay on task, on focus, and refrain from that impulse, which is so human, right? Next one. So the interpreter's role, the way we see it, helps the therapeutic process. We're talking about trauma counseling, and trauma is all about the rupture of trust and safety. So the interpreter's biggest role is to help us create that safety in the here and now, in this present moment in the room, help us establish this trusting relationship. So boundaries are key, and the previous presenters have already tapped on the key role of boundaries. And that's the foundation to help us meet our clinical goals. And another comment that I wanted to make about this usual comment, this usual suggestion to use interpreters, to reach out to interpreters as cultural consultants or brokers. Doing that in conversations, pre or after sessions, we do believe in that. And we do believe in this in the context of also recognizing within group differences. So the interpreter's knowledge about a specific cultural group has to be put in perspective with this understanding that people from same cultures have different perspectives of that culture. Right? This may sound obvious, but we cannot emphasize that enough. The next one. So, good interpretation is one that helps us advance the therapeutic goals. In order to accomplish this, together with the interpreter and the client in the room, the interpreter's presence and grounding, that body attunement is key, and that ongoing journey of self-actualization and that critique, right? Inner supervision of interpreter. That we can collaborate with through consultation, because we definitely suggest that we therapists and interpreters meet before and after session to brief the brief. That's a key part of our work together, whether it's before individual sessions and or group sessions, because we work with interpreters in both settings. So about that, I wanted to say, next one, the group setting piece. And I know that Yolanda will be covering this more, but the same principles apply, right? What we need, in terms of what we need from interpreters. We suggest whisper or simultaneous interpretation in groups because there are so many languages in the room. We have language corner, as Michael described that. Remember to come back to the group. And this may sound obvious, but we so many times have to remind interpreters, right? Let's not lose the group. And let us put this out there. There are some very specific challenges to confidentiality, or maybe exacerbated challenges to confidentiality that happen with, that come up when interpreters interpret in a group setting. Let us picture the situation. A given interpreter may have access to information about this client because he has interpreted in a one-on-one session. So how to set that aside, right? So, or the before and after group situation. So there are definitely some specific challenges or enhanced challenges, and we wanted to recognize that. And that's about it. Next one, acknowledging that I'm looking forward to questions, to sharing, and to the back and forth that is coming toward the end.
So thank you, Mariana. Thank you so much for sharing the insights from the perspective of working through a counseling session, working with an interpreter. So thank you so much. I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Young Jo, who is a certified medical interpreter. And Young has worked as a professional interpreter primary in healthcare and community for over 10 years and is a passionate advocate of language access and the professionalization of community and healthcare interpreting. Young Jo founded Bilinguist International as a vehicle to champion the continued professionalization of interpreters by providing interprofessional training on how to work with interpreters to students in healthcare and social work discipline at UBC. So I'd like to welcome Young to talk about how to work effectively with interpreters.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Young Jo, medical interpreter, and I also work for Bilinguals International. Today, I will talk about how to work effectively with interpreters. Today, I will give you a brief introduction about Bilinguals International, and we'll talk about what is wrong with having family members as interpreters. Aren't they the one who know us best? Maybe we want to use family members, and we'll see if it's good or bad. And then we will talk about how to work effectively with professional interpreters before, during, and after the session. Or if there was absolutely no professional interpreters available, but we need to have someone who need to help us with interpreting for the session, as a last resort, we may have to use bilingual person to interpret for the session. So there's a very specific things we have to look out for in the situation. So we'll talk briefly about that too. Next, please. So let's do some exercise here. Who would be the best or worst interpreter in this case? So 52-year-old female Korean-speaking patient meets with a male radiation oncologist after a series of radiation therapy for her cervical cancer, which can be very sensitive to talk about. The doctor will ask questions to find out if the patient is having any side effects. So the question will be involved something with asking the patient questions about bowel movement or her urination habit or irritable bladder, etc. Again, something that is that can be very sensitive to talk about. Next slide, please. So who can be the best or the worst interpreter? Number one, the husband, who happens to be a surgeon. So he may have, he will have great knowledge in medicine. Number two will be the daughter, who's a lawyer, so have some intelligence and understanding about may or may not have knowledge in medicine, but may have very good relationship as a daughter, as a female, about the patient. Or the female friend of the patient who happens to be obstetrics or gynecologist, the doctor for women in South Korea. So we tend to share a lot of things that we cannot share with our family to our female friends. So maybe that person, the friend, can be the best. Or maybe the hospital had this Korean-speaking nurse who understand the situation with a cancer and also speak in Korean and may or may not know the culture. So if you can have quick thought and opinion, you can maybe select one who can be the best interpreter in this case. I'll give you 5 seconds.
So Young, while you've been explaining the different options, we've been having the poll open. And so many people have been voting, and so we do have a clear front runner. Over 3/4 of the participants have said the best interpreter would be the Korean-speaking nurse. The second best would be the female friend of the patient. And right now, the husband and daughter are tied with 3% thinking that they would be a suitable interpreter.
Thank you very much. Next slide, please. So these 1, 2, 3, 4 are all the worst interpreters. And the best interpreters, I kind of tricked you here, but best interpreter will be the professional interpreter. But I know that you would have picked the professional interpreters if that option was there, but I still omitted that option so you can actually think about different things, what can go on between these options. So let me give you a case where the conversation can go wrong if you use a daughter as bilingual aid. So maybe you're wondering about what is this bilingual language aid? I don't even want to call bilingual speaking husband, bilingual speaking daughter, or friend, or bilingual nurse as an interpreter. They are not an interpreter. They are just there to help the situation, to communicate with each other. So for example, when we need a CPR, when we have car accident, and when I see the person, but there's no doctors around, person who has a first aid certificate may come and help you with a CPR. But we know that they are not doctors or nurses. They are first aid certificate owned individual. But we are not going to rely on them for very important decision making. They are aid. So this bilingual speaking person we may use in worst case scenario, they are bilingual language aid, not an interpreter. So that's why I put them in a separate category as previous slide, please. Thank you. So I will give you some time to read this situation. How do you feel after the treatment? And then daughter says in different language, Ma, she's asking how you're feeling. The patient says, I just feel sick and tired of this pain. But daughter says, she complains about being in pain a lot. Anyway, she's always doing this. And then oncologist says, where the pain is? And then daughter's asking, where's the hurt, Ma? Next slide, please. And then patient goes on and on about her not visiting her father's grave enough and thinks that her father's spirit is hurting her. She's not talking about side effect. And she's talking about how she doesn't care about the treatment. The daughter and patient having their own conversation, and when oncologist asks what's going on, daughter just says, oh, nothing, it's just family stuff. Next slide, please. You may think that, oh, is this really happened? But yes, it happens every day, or even somewhere right now at this moment at the hospital where the professional interpreter is not present. So what's the problem here? The problem is the daughter omitted and added information. What would a professional interpreter have done differently? The professional interpreter would have interpreted everything the patient said. So doctor knows that the patient is most likely very reluctant to follow any instruction the doctor would give her, for example, like taking medication, etc., because she has no trust in the treatment. If the doctor knew about this, he would have paid, or she would have paid more attention and put efforts on educating the patient for side effect control, and that would have prevented possible ER visits from suffering from side effect. As an attending professional, especially medical professional, how can you make this situation better? So doctors or nurses should ask the same question again directly to the patient by looking at the patient, and at the same time ask the daughter to interpret every single thing the patient said. So you, as a professional, you are the one who's managing the session. So if you notice this kind of thing happens, you have to control the situation. So here we'll talk about what to do before and during and after the session. So these contents are what Bilinguals International is offering in their workshop. So Bilinguals International is a nonprofit organization, and its mission is to offer workshops to healthcare, social services, and settlement services providers on how to work effectively with interpreters and not to use bilingual staff, family members, and friends. So before the session, if possible, you should have short pre-session dialogue with interpreters. In some cases, if you can give the interpreter just a few sentences about the purpose of the session, this dialogue can make a huge difference. They will provide a context the interpreters may need, such as if the session is just routine follow-up or very delicate situation, so interpreters can prepare to convey the appropriate tone. So for example, like Mariana just talked about, whenever I interpreted for the VAS, which I've done before, I really had to prepare myself emotionally and actually physically. Sometimes I would have been really happy and I was in a very, very vibrant mood, but when I walk into the office, I will try to have very humble and quiet tone, not too much of vibrant tone in my voice. And so pre-dialogue, we can talk about background information and cultural issues, and make sure to write down interpreter's name and ID number on client's file. So during the session, sit in triangle sitting arrangement. So when you are talking, look directly at your client first and say, tell him or her that we're going to use professional interpreter, and he or she will talk what? Everything the client will say in the session. So if there's anything they don't want to be conveyed, they should not talk about it. Just don't say like, oh, interpreter, I actually have these secret things, but don't tell doctor. Because the interpreter would interpret that to the doctor, exactly. Next slide, please. Again, looking directly and speaking directly to the client or the patient is very, very important. So say, how can I help you? directly to the client. Don't say or looking at interpreter saying, ask him how I can help. Just pretend that interpreters are not even there. If you're using a phone interpreter, try not to look at the phone. Just look directly again. Look directly to your patient or client. And when you speak, speak normally and pause after two or three complete sentences. Complete sentence is very important because if you just stop in the middle of the sentence, interpreter may not be able to convey the whole message because in some languages, the word or sentence order is very different. And avoid slang, jargon, and metaphor. Try to talk in a very straightforward manner. And another very important thing is be vigilant about what the interaction between client and interpreter. Because although you don't speak their languages, you can still tell what's going on between and if the sentence is too short compared to what you actually said, or if the sentences are too long compared to what you said. After the session, you have to debrief professional interpreter, especially the session was emotionally taxing, or if you require clarification on some cultural issues. Next slide, please. Next one is a little bit different. This one, you are dealing with bilingual language aid who may speak two languages, but they don't know how to interpret. So again, write down who is doing this language aid job and the relationship to the client in your case file for your information later. And you must have pre-session dialogue about how they're going to interpret in this session. Make sure that you tell them they have to interpret every single thing the client says without omitting, adding, or altering the message. And they have to speak in person. So they should not say, Mom, doctor is asking how you're doing. They shouldn't say that. They should say in the first person. So during the session, you have to make it clear that you're going to use your daughter as language aid and again, interpret everything you say in the room will be communicated. Next slide, please. Again, it's very similar. The only difference is make it even shorter when you speak. So now instead of two or three sentences, you have to pause after one or two short, complete sentences. Next slide, please. Make sure to debrief the bilingual language aid, especially when they are a family member. And also clarify in culture, language and culture issues, or even the family issues if there's anything to be helped with. And the most important thing is by debriefing your client about the role of this language aid, so they don't actually have conflict between them after the session. I think this is the last slide. So now you learned how to work effectively with both professional interpreters and bilingual person. I hope together we can help the population with limited English proficiency better. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Young, and thank you for giving us so much valuable information. And if there's any questions, please direct them and put them into the question box and we will try and get to them after the webinar, or if we're not able to, I will definitely be forwarding those to Young as well. So I'd like to present our next speaker, who is Annette Floyd. Annette is a nurse who has worked in refugee healthcare for more than 9 years. She is currently the clinical coordinator at Bridge Clinic, a Vancouver Coastal Health Clinic, which provides initial health screening and primary care for newly arrived refugees to the Greater Vancouver area. Since December 2015, Annette has been coordinating the healthcare response for more than 1,500 government-assisted Syrian refugees who have been destined to the Greater Vancouver area. And Annette will be sharing with us briefly some practical examples in regards to you working with interpreters in the medical setting.
Hi, everyone. So, yeah, we can go right ahead to the next slide. So I'm just going to talk briefly about some of the advantages and disadvantages and barriers to working with medical interpreters and the differences between professional and lay interpreters, and also how to access interpreters. You can go to the next slide. So when's it appropriate to use medical interpreters? Obviously with any healthcare interaction, when the client doesn't have enough English to fully understand what's being said. And some ways that you can kind of determine that is see if a client is able to kind of give instructions back to you to kind of explain what's been said to them. And if they aren't able to do that, then you really need to look at getting an interpreter. And it's particularly important when you're taking a medical history or when you are giving a client instructions about perhaps discharge instructions or instructions of how to take medications or something. That's when it becomes particularly important to have an interpreter. Next slide. So we know there's a lot of research about the fact that clients adhere to their medications better, they follow up better on medical conditions, they have a decreased rate of hospitalization if they've had access to an interpreter. And it's also really tricky about getting consent for medical procedures if you don't have an interpreter, obviously. And I would be really cautious of patients who speak a little bit of English, because that can also often really trip people up, that people tend to just nod and agree to things and say that they've understood things when in fact they don't. So don't assume just because someone's saying that they understood that they actually did. Go to the next slide. So some of the barriers from a healthcare worker's perspective. I'm going to talk about PLS, which is the Provincial Language Services soon. It's available in all health authorities to a varying degree, but a lot of the time the individual healthcare worker might not know that it's available and might not know how to use it. They sometimes think it takes too long. They'd rather just get the janitor who speaks Cantonese to interpret. And there can sometimes be a cost to medical interpretation that the healthcare provider isn't willing to bear. And I think there's a lack of appreciation by healthcare providers to both the client's experience of getting healthcare when they don't speak English, and I think it's a lack of understanding of the ethical and legal risk that medical providers have if they're not using professional interpreters. And go to the next slide. So Provincial Language Services is an on-site or telephone professional medical interpretation service. It's available through all the different health authorities in the province to a varying degree. It can be booked online ahead of time, and they are also able to call clients and do third-party calls for you as well. Next slide. So as I said, all the healthcare facilities do have access to it in the province. So what I'm meaning by that is a private doctor's office doesn't necessarily have access or would have to pay for this service. But anytime you're in a hospital or a health authority facility, they do have access to it. Some of the Northern Health units, Northern Health and Interior Health, there's no central funding for it, so they might have to pay, the unit specifically will have to pay. And then some of the what are called divisions of family practice in Burnaby, Tri-Cities, Vancouver, Comox, and also Shuswap, North Okanagan, they're all doing pilot projects right now where individual family doctors in their office can have access to this service as well. Next slide. So can you use family members? We really highly discourage it, but we recognize that at some time that's all that's available, and it may in fact be better than no interpreter at all. What we need to remember though is that family members, as was mentioned before, don't have the medical vocabulary. They may omit information, and it's particularly stressful for children to have to interpret for their parents if they're kind of finding out about medical issues with their parents that they didn't previously know about. It can cause a lot of stress to children and worry. And I'm always really cautious when we have husbands that insist on interpreting for their wives all the time, because you always kind of need to be aware of the possibility of, is there domestic abuse? Is there something that he doesn't want her to be able to say to a healthcare provider without him listening in? So that's kind of a red flag for me. Next slide. And we talked about this already, that professional interpreters, about confidentiality and privacy and written contracts. And again, as was mentioned by previous speakers, that if you're using lay interpreters or family members, you really need to have a conversation ahead of time with them about the need for confidentiality. Next
Thank
slide.
You. Thank you so much, Annette. It's been great hearing from the perspective of the medical profession in using interpreters. And you're going to be coming, we're going to be welcoming you back shortly to talk a little bit about the culture of interpreting. But beforehand, I would just like to welcome back Yolanda Salazar-Hoboro, who's going to be talking about the logistics and culture of interpreting.
Okay, I'm back again.
Yes, you are.
And we're going to be talking about logistics of interpreting.
And
can you hear me all right?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, we're going to start with over-the-phone interpreting. Over-the-phone interpreting is something that is growing all over the place because it is so difficult to get an interpreter sometimes. Then we're going to be talking about interpreters working in group settings and working with multiple interpreters. And I think that we're adding the next step presentation, which has to do with gender usage and culture. So let's go on. Let's start now. Number over the phone interpreting, there are two ways of talking, working over the phone. If you have an immediate situation that you need to do, you need an interpreter right away, you cannot wait for the person to arrive, then you can call a telephone service. And PLS does have some telephone service. I think they actually subscribe to an American service. But that is not available to other social services agencies. There is a Canadian over-the-phone interpreting service called CanTalk. They're based out of Winnipeg. And the advantages of CanTalk over Saracom or LanguageLine, which are both very good, is that you pay in Canadian dollars, and the interpreters are mostly Canadian, so they would be familiar with some of the terms that we use in Canada, like the medical services card and the workers' compensation, which is called Work PC. If you get an American interpreter, they may not know what is going on, and they will come up with a very different translation of the term. So if you have to do that one, you call CanTalk, for example, and you can place the phone, you pay by the minute. So it can be a fairly affordable call if it is under 15 minutes. After 15 minutes, it becomes quite expensive. Next. The other type of over-the-phone interpreting is when you have month consultations, examinations for discovery, hearings, or just meetings between a lawyer and a client or between a doctor and patient. And the calls are usually going to be 15 minutes or longer. Sometimes, say, you may be working at a hearing that will take 1 or 2 hours. And so those hearings are usually scheduled in advance with the interpreter. The interpreter gets documents that are going to be pertinent to the session, and then when the call is completed, it might take anywhere between half an hour and 2.5 hours. It is a very easy way to have a communication with your client if you don't have an interpreter who speaks that language in town. The one advantage of telephone interpreting, according to one of my clients, is that when he is in a room with a speaker between them, they look at each other and they listen, and they get to know each other much better because there's no interference of the third person who is there, and they are basically taking some attention from each other to pay attention to the interpreter. Next. And then when we have interpreting in group settings, there's a lot of different situations where we have group settings. If you have one person who doesn't speak the language, an NES speaker, in a large group, then you have the interpreter sitting next to him doing whisper interpreting and only doing consecutive when the person has to say something to the group. If you have two people in a group, then the interpreter sits between the two of them, and sometimes it's a challenge to figure out which way to turn your head, because if you turn it one way, the other doesn't hear. The interpreter has to sit a little bit behind so that the two of them can listen at the same time. And if you have more than two non-English speakers, then it is recommended that the interpreter has conference equipment. There is very good portable conference equipment that the interpreter can use, and all the people who do not speak the language of the meeting can listen to everything in their own language. Next. When you're working with multiple interpreters in the same setting, if you have, and I think that you do that in some areas, then the interpreters have to be fully briefed before the session begins. They have to know who the presenters are going to be, what are the topics that are going to be discussed, what is the mode of interpreting that is going to be used, is it going to be consecutive, is it going to be simultaneous. And one of the very important things to remember when you are talking in a group is that people tend to speak a lot faster when they're giving a speech than when they're talking, and so the interpreters have a real challenge keeping up with people, with fast speakers. Sometimes the easiest thing is to have all the people who speak the same language sitting together with the interpreter between them. And if the interpreter has portable equipment, then that will make it very easily. Some of the portable equipment that is available has more than one channel, so you can have different channels for different languages, and you can have as many languages as you have channels in your system. And if it is going to be a large group, then I think that separate rooms may be required for the speaker, for the groups, or maybe just get conference interpreting equipment and put the interpreters in a booth. And that would probably be the easiest way to do it. Now, going on to the next one, interpreters from the same country. We have a lot of issues about interpreters from the same country. You can have personal family connections. You might find out that the person that you're going to be interpreting for is a distant relative, or it's a friend of your mother's, or something like that. So there is something that you have to canvas to make sure that there is not going to be any conflict, any personal conflict or conflict of interests. If you're dealing with a small language community in one of the towns and everybody knows everybody in the community, then a good idea would be to get somebody from out of town. And in that case, you might want to get a telephone interpreting service to provide the interpreter for you for the meeting, or bring somebody from another town, which is normally done here in Vancouver. We bring interpreters from other towns when we have to deal with a very small community where everybody knows everybody. Also, when you have interpreters coming from the same country or from the same geographical area, there are expectations from both parties, both from the provider and the client. The provider will expect the interpreter to have some insights into the client's background or into the culture of the area. And on the other hand, the client is going to see the interpreter as a personal support, as an advocate who is going to help them navigate through the system. And so it's a very delicate place for the interpreter to be, because you have to be there being neutral, attending to the needs of both parties and making sure that no lines are crossed and that you are not bending one way or bending the other as the needs of the client or the provider come up. And there is always a problem with conflict. Now, gender usage. We have a lot. It has to do with basically three types of issues that we have to think about. What is the setting? Is the setting going to be a medical examination? What the topic is going to be? Is it going to be a lawyer talking to a client who has been accused of sexual abuse? And who are the participants at the meeting? You want to have the same gender interpreter in medical settings if at all possible. If it is not possible, you might rely on telephone interpreting. Or if you have to have somebody from the opposite gender, then it would be wise to have some sort of a physical barrier, like a screen, or basically the interpreter would sit away from the group and basically facing in another direction while the examination is going on, for the comfort of the patient, for the comfort of the interpreter, especially in the case of a female patient and a female doctor. If they have a male interpreter, that could be quite crushing and quite upsetting to the patient. And also who the participants are. In a court setting, for example, it might be a female interpreter interpreting for a male client who is accused of sexual abuse and he's answering questions of his lawyer. On the other hand, if it is a female client, a female victim, she might prefer to have a female interpreter and a female lawyer acting in court at that moment. So it's basically is we have to do it on our own discretion to make sure that no boundaries, no cultural boundaries are crossed when we call interpreters for particular settings. And this is really short. Now, and as far as resources, we the Language Bureau is the parent company of the Vancouver School of Interpreting, and our resources, basically, we have a database of over 3,000 interpreters, and we know personally a lot of them, not all of them, of course, because some of them are out of town, but we try to find out about our interpreters, what they like, what they prefer, what kind of what kind of situations are they familiar with, because the interpreter really is the most important resource that you have to address the needs of non-English speaking newcomers. And having ethical and trained interpreters is a goal that we all have here in the province. That is why I'm working in this school. My goal is to train as many interpreters in as many languages as possible to serve the needs of the community. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Yolanda. Thank you for sharing, and particularly looking at not just the logistics of interpreting from the various different perspectives, but also bringing into the aspects of gender and culture. And so I'd like to welcome Annette Floyd back, who's going to be sharing with us some practical examples from the field in regards to culture and working with interpreters. Annette?
Hi, yeah, we can go right ahead to the next slide. Yeah, so I'll talk just a little bit. I know Yolanda just covered some of this, so I'll just go through it really briefly. Next slide. I think, you know, there are some advantages to using interpreters from the same country, especially around dialect and cultural familiarity. And then disadvantages, Yolanda really talked about that a lot, especially in smaller communities, that can be a big concern. I think with refugees, one thing we notice is that you know, the conflicts that drove people out of their countries, those don't dissolve the minute you land on Canadian soil. And so we have issues sometimes with people not trusting interpreters that come from a different ethnic group that was perhaps part of on the other side of the conflict in their home country. Next slide. And again, we've talked about this a little bit already. As far as gender goes, really don't book male interpreters for female gynecological medical exams, for sure. The women don't like it, and the male interpreters really don't like it either. And I think Yolanda covered a lot of the things about domestic violence and even mental health as well. Next slide. I think I'll just end with one little story. We've been talking about professional interpreters and the need for professional interpreters, but I did my master's research on non-English speaking refugee women that arrived recently to Canada and their access to medical care. And one woman I interviewed had been in the emergency room just a few days after she arrived, and the doctor had a professional interpreter on the phone, and then noticed that the visitor at a couple beds down spoke this woman's language, so hung up with the professional interpreter and got the visitor to interpret for this woman. And I was horrified, but I said to the woman, I said, how did you feel about that when he did that? And she actually thought it was the kindest thing this doctor could have done, was to introduce her to a woman from her own country and to allow this woman to interpret it for her. So sometimes what we as professionals think is right and what the clients themselves really value are not always the same thing. And I'll just finish with that.
So thank you so much, Annette. And thank you for sharing with us that, giving us that thought that it's really what's best for the client, and that is not always what we assume could be best. And so I would like to introduce our final speaker for today, Brian Corey. Brian is a registered American Sign Language English interpreter and a BC-accredited medical sign language interpreter practicing in the Lower Mainland. His practice spans community, medical, deaf-blind, and post-secondary interpreting. He has recently returned to university with the goal of obtaining a graduate degree and improving healthcare and medical interpreting services for language minorities. And Brian will be sharing with us some insights into working with a signed language interpreter. So welcome, Brian.
Thank you so much. This morning, I just want to very briefly to touch on what a sign language interpreter is and give you a few tips on how to work with a sign language interpreter. In the interest of time, I might skip over a few parts that are not as salient. So the first thing to note is that American Sign Language is grammatically and structurally different from English, and that sign languages are not universal. There's many different sign languages. So when you're working with an immigrant or refugee from another country, it's not necessarily that they share a sign language. In fact, often some people will come with no language at all and start learning a language when they arrive in Canada. And also within Canada, that sometimes happens as well. Deaf culture is unique from the majority culture as well. So when you're working with refugees and immigrants, you can't assume that their culture or the culture they were raised in is this exactly the same as the majority of the country of origin. Moving to the next slide. Sign language interpretation and spoken language interpretation is similar in many aspects. We work in all the settings that Michael mentioned, with a few additional settings. Post-secondary is a very common place for you to find sign language interpreters, as well as within the K-12 system. And then in medical situations, there's funding for sign language interpreters in both primary and acute and emergency care. So doctor's appointments are fully funded. The differences between a sign language interpreter and a spoken language interpreter there are a few. Specifically, there's a change in modality from a spoken medium to a visual language, and that allows us the option to produce a simultaneous interpretation even within a small group meeting. However, a sign language interpreter might make the choice to produce a consecutive interpretation in areas that are more complex or in areas that need a little bit more clarity. Sign language interpreters are often second language users of ASL. While they're fluent, they did with a lot of them didn't grow up within the ASL community and learned ASL later in life, and they belong to the D culture, the non-deaf culture most often, and that has implications. It's pretty easy within BC to ensure that you're working with a qualified sign language interpreter. The best way to do that is just to ask for a Waverly or ABLIC membership card, and that ensures that the interpreter abides by a code of ethics and that they graduated from a minimum of a two-year interpreter education program. Moving to the next slide. Deaf interpreters are interpreters that are themselves deaf. They're almost ubiquitously L1 users or first language users of American Sign Language, and often know to various degrees other sign languages as well. They're members of the minority language and culture, and they're highly skilled at cultural and linguistic adaptation, and they're very skilled at working with emergent language users and limited language users who are deaf. And so they can be vital when working with refugee and immigrant populations and as well as specific populations that were born and raised in Canada. Moving to the next slide. All the tips so far for working with spoken language interpreters definitely apply for sign language interpreters. Briefing and debriefing with the interpreter is vital, and allowing time for the interpreter to briefly connect with the deaf person allows for rapport, trust, and linguistic understanding to be developed. Again, we're coming into this situation not being associated with deaf culture and the community, but not necessarily being a core member of that community. So that time allows us to know who this person is, their background, and develop a working relationship. And again, expect and plan for conversations through an interpreter to take a little bit more time. And how much time in addition it might take, it depends on setting a lot of different things. Moving to the next slide. The physical arrangement of interpreters is different depending on a number of factors, but in general, in one-on-one meetings, common float practice currently is for the interpreter to sit beside the non-deaf person with the deaf person sitting across or in front of them. However, emerging practice that, based on research that looks into how physical layout can imply conversational bias or alignment, suggests that interpreters sit an equal distance between the non-deaf and the deaf participant in the triangle formation that Yan Zhou mentioned. And so you'll see that more and more in the coming years. Moving to the next slide. In large group presentations, it's ideal for the interpreter to stand beside the presenter and near whatever PowerPoint there is. The other consideration is to ensure that the deaf participants within at the presentation have a clear sight line to the interpreter. Moving to the next slide, there's really no standard of practice when it comes to the physical arrangement of deaf interpreters because it's highly contextual and complex. And so the best practice is to discuss the seating arrangements with the interpreters, and deaf interpreters generally work with a hearing interpreter or non-deaf interpreter as well. So it's great to have that meeting prior. And I would also mention that the seating and physical arrangements are dependent on a lot, no matter if there's a deaf interpreter or not. So these are generalities, but specific practice might change based on a number of things. Moving on to the last slide, if you want more information, please feel free to check out the Waverly website. That's the Provincial Association of Visual Language Interpreters. Or you can tweet at me on Twitter, and my handle is @PCInterpreter, and I'm more than happy to have any number of discussions and answer any questions. Thank you.
So thank you, Brian, and thank you for sharing with us how to work with a sign language interpreter. We do we've now come to the Q&A session of our presentation, which will be a short question period due to a timing. I do want to honor all the questions that have come in, so we will be sending those out to all the presenters so that they can provide written feedback if they would like to the question that is pertaining to them. Also, we will be going a few minutes over our time, but I just want to acknowledge that since we had scheduled the webinar to 11:30, that as a participant, that if you needed to leave the webinar, that that we understand and you're more than welcome. But there are a couple of questions that we would like to come to. And one of the questions is, what should you do if a client prefers to use a family member, friend as an interpreter instead of a professional interpreter? And I think, Annette, this is something that you had addressed in your example. So I wanted to forward this question to you.
Yeah, I think it's difficult, and it probably depends from a medical clinician. For me, it might depend a bit on what the situation was for the interpretation. I mean, you always want to kind of honor clients' wishes, and certainly we would always allow them to use their family member if that's what they really wanted. But I think I'd also have a conversation with the client about, you know, the fact that the family member might not have the same medical knowledge and things like that. But certainly we've had clients that have only ever used their children or their spouses as interpreters, and that's always been their choice. So I think I would honor that.
Thank you so much. And the next question is going to be for Yolanda. And that one is, what tips can you give on how to minimize conflict of interest with community interpreters who are from the same country or culture?
Very good question. The answer is a little bit complicated. I think that one of the things that would be fantastic would be if we could pick from the different community groups that come into BC, pick the ones who speak the best English and train them to be interpreters. I don't know we're not doing, why we're not doing it. But I think that really the only way that we can do that is by providing some proper training, especially the training in ethics and also some of the role plays that we have, because it's a lot easier to understand the conflict of interests when you see it, when you talk about it in a non-confrontational setting than if you have to do it with the interpreter right there ready to start the session. It's a difficult issue because sometimes you get last minute surprises that will really send the interpreter out on a limb. But I think that just talking to them in advance and canvassing the people who do speak the language in your area and find out who might want to become an interpreter and then encourage them to become so. Conflict of interest always surprise the participants. They're never planned.
Well, thank you so much.
I don't think this is the perfect answer, but it's the best I can do. But talking about when the client wants to have a family member there to interpret, what my clients have done in the past is I said, okay, you may be at the meeting, you may correct the interpreter if you think that she's making a mistake, but I rather work with my interpreter because I know how she works.
Well, thank you so much, Yolanda. And then the next question is going to be for Michael. One of them, as a professional association, is where can we find training and support, either face-to-face or online, for interpreters who are working in a mental health setting?
Well, unfortunately, there aren't a lot of different places to get training from, but there are some institutions in town that can offer that, and that's something people can contact our society and we'll give them the appropriate information.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Michael. So I just wanted to close the webinar, but so that for individuals who do need to leave so that they receive the information about the webinar can be posted online, but we will still honor one or two questions after this brief closing. So we will be mailing out an evaluation form of the webinar following the presentation. So we do ask you that you fill it out as AMHSA relies on the feedback provided to plan future events and training. So it's very helpful for us to take the feedback to see what topics you would like going forward. I would also like to say a special thanks to all of our speakers today for giving us their time and expertise in helping support the settlement sector in learning more about using an interpreter. And I'd also like to thank the AMHSA team for putting this webinar together, for all the tech end and for tweeting and providing all the support. And of course, I would like to thank Immigration, Refugees and Citizenship Canada, IRCC, for funding this event. As I mentioned earlier, this webinar has been recorded and it will be posted on the AMHSA website, and we will be sending out a notification via SettlementNet once it is online. So one of the final questions that I have is, and this is going to, I think, for Young, because you were mentioning it in your presentation a little bit. Is an in-person interpreter or a telephone interpreter, is it better, especially when you have the option, or if you don't have an option, what would you work with?
Always in-person is better, because you can also tell the body language, and also the interpreter can see the body language of the patient or client. They can be interpreted differently by English-speaking professional. So then interpreter will interject the conversation, say, by raising hand, say, interpreter would like to comment on blah, 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 and then clarify cultural aspect that can be missed by phone interpreting. But as Yolanda said, in some situation, phone interpreting can be better for confidentiality or for the sensitive issues a patient or client can be not very comfortable with. So I wouldn't say one is always better than the other. It depends on the situation.
Thank you so much. And the final question for today is, is it better to ask the clients which gender interpreter they prefer, or should you automatically try to find a same gender interpreter for the situations that were mentioned? And I'd like to address this one to Annette again.
I know we tend to always try to book female interpreters for any kind of pap tests and things like that. And male interpreters, for men as well, I mean, obviously you don't always know what the appointment's going to involve. I think, ideally we try to book gender concordant interpreters whenever possible. And then you could certainly ask the clients ahead of time, because some women are quite comfortable with male interpreters and vice versa. But I think really always kind of putting it back to the client and asking the client what they would prefer is always your first best choice.
Thank you so much, Annette, and thank you for everyone for participating in today's webinar. The webinar will be posted on the AMHSA website together with all resources that have been shared with me from the presenters. As well, I will be forwarding all the questions that we received to the presenters so that they can provide written feedback and send this out to everyone who's registered for the webinar. Thank you again. Goodbye.